Welcome to LankanTutor. Today we'll be starting Unit 2. The lesson is Elemental Composition of Living Matter. If you are not watching this at LankanTutor.com, we do suggest you do so, as it has some written tutorials which can help you out. If you want the full details, the link is in the description below. We all know what an element is. It's a pure substance which comprises of one atom with specific atomic numbers. But how many elements does it take to build a plant or an animal? And what are they? We'll be covering what you need to know about the composition of living matter in this tutorial. There are 92 naturally occurring elements, and from those, 20 could be seen in living matter. So we'll be looking at how these 20 elements function with one another and how they actually work inside our body. Carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. Remember these. These are the most common or abundant type of naturally occurring elements in every living organism, and every living organism has all 20 of these elements. Elements are classified into two categories depending on their abundance inside organisms. Specifically, the percentage they exist in. If it's more than 0.01% of the dry weight, they are considered macroelements. Any less, it's considered as a trace element. The macroelements and trace elements are different in plants and animals. In animals, the macroelements are carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, potassium, calcium, magnesium, sodium, iron, and chloride. The trace elements in animals are boron, manganese, zinc, copper, molybdenum, aluminium, silicon, and vanadium. In plants, it's almost the same. The only difference, however, is that sodium, iron, and chloride, which happen to be macroelements in animals, are moved on to the trace element category. Okay, so we know what the elements are, but how do they exist in our body? In what form and what are their uses? Let's start with the most common element, which happens to be oxygen, if you didn't know that. Even though we are considered carbon-based life forms, oxygen is the most common element because we're considering this as dry weight, and the majority of the human body consists of water. Molecular formula of water is H2O, two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. Now, if you know about the molecular weights, oxygen is much heavier than hydrogen, and hence in dry weight, the majority of oxygen actually comes from water. Next, we have carbon, which is around 20%, 18.5 to be exact. You guys don't really need to know what percentage they're in, but you do need to know which one of them are trace elements and which one of them are macroelements in plants and animals. So you might want to remember that. So carbon is a component of organic molecules like proteins and carbohydrates, and everything has carbon. Hydrogen is 9.5%, and this is because of water and organic molecules. Nitrogen is 3.3%. The main thing you need to remember about nitrogen is it's a component of amino acids. Amino acids are the monomers or building blocks of proteins. Around 20 amino acids get together to form protein molecules. And chlorophyll and coenzymes and enzymes also have nitrogen. The next part is phosphorus. Now, this only amounts up to around 1%, but that's still a lot, considering 1% is a big deal. The next thing is phosphorus. Now, that only amounts to 1%, but that is a lot. Remember that if it's only below 0.01%, that is considered a trace element. Phosphorus is a component of ATP and ADP. If you don't know what these are the main energy units of the human body. Adenosine triphosphate and adenosine diphosphate. When the phosphate groups of ATP and ADP break, into AMP, that releases energy, and that's the energy we use to carry out our day-to-day metabolic functions. It's also a component of phospholipids and coenzymes. Don't worry about what phospholipids are and what coenzymes are, because during the next few units, you'll be learning in detail about what they actually are. Calcium is 1.5%. Now, it's different for animals and plants. In animals, you know that calcium is a part of your bones and teeth. That's fairly common knowledge, but the interesting part is, without calcium, you can't have nervous transmission and muscular contraction, which means you can't move or your brain can't send signals. That's a really important thing about calcium, which people tend to ignore. Even though it's a component of bones and teeth, nervous transmission and muscular contraction is very important. The next thing is in plants. It's a component of the cell wall, and it's also used to maintain the permeability of the membrane, how much fluid there's in the cell, and send them in and out and control the permeability. And it's also an activator of enzymes. So remember what calcium can do, because calcium is pretty important. It's in animals, it's a component of bones, teeth. It helps in muscular contraction and nervous transmission. In plants, it's a component of cell walls. It maintains the membrane permeability and the membrane structure. It's also an activator of enzymes. So now we're going to go below the 1%. But remember, we're not at trace elements yet. Potassium is 0.4% of the human dry mass. It's used in protein synthesis. It's also an activator of enzymes, and it helps the function of the stomata. If you don't know what the stomata is a part of a plant which helps in transpiration, and there's a whole part about how potassium helps the opening and closing of the stomata by controlling the solute and potential levels of the stomata, of the guard cells around the stomata to be precise. The next thing is sulfur. Sulfur is a component of amino acids, which means it's also a component of proteins and coenzyme A. And when I say it's a component of amino acids, it's a given that it's a component of protein. Next, we move on to chlorine. Chlorine also helps the functionality of the nerves, and it's also a component of the vacuolar sap and regulates ionic balances and osmosis. The vacuolar sap is this fluid-filled sac covered by a membrane called the tonoplast inside the cell. In unit 2.3, we'll be learning about the vacuolar sap, the nucleus, the cell membranes, and how they all function. So if you need to understand what the vacuolar sap is, you can go to unit 2.3 and check that out. It regulates ionic balance and osmosis. Basically, it controls the concentration gradient and moves it in and out of the cell. So next we're at iron. Chlorophyll synthesis in plants, and it's also present in cytochrome and nitrogenase. So now, nitrogenase is an enzyme. Remember, everything which has an ACE is an enzyme. For example, in nitrogenase, it's an enzyme which helps break down nitrogen. And then we have sodium. It's present in tissue fluids, and it's also necessary for nervous transmission. Now remember, sodium and calcium is needed for nervous transmission. Then we move on to trace elements. The trace elements, there's not a lot, but the general function is to activate enzymes. Manganese and zinc are enzyme activators. Boron is used in nucleic acid synthesis. Copper is an enzyme activator as well as a component of enzymes. And molybdenum is used in nitrogen fixation. Now, in this unit, it doesn't seem like a lot, but the thing is, you have to memorize each and everything you see here. You need to remember what the macro elements are. You need to remember what the trace elements are. You need to remember how it differentiates between plants and animals. You need to remember the six most common naturally occurring elements, which are carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. You need to know that there are 92 naturally occurring elements, and out of them, 20 could be found in the living body. If you know all of that and you have a general idea and you know what the function of each element is, you don't need to know the quantity. The quantity is given so you can get a general idea of how much of that particular element there is. But other than that, you don't need to memorize it. You do need to know is that what they do: oxygen for aerobic respiration, component of organic molecules, carbon for organic molecules, and so on, like we said before. And if you can remember all of this stuff, congratulations, you're good to go, and we'll be moving on to 2.2, where we'll be discussing the properties of water. So, I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and if it did, please do leave a like below and subscribe to this channel. If you're watching this on LankanTutor.com, all we ask you to do is try and share it with one of your friends who you think will benefit from this video. Thank you guys for watching. See you again next time. Have a great day.